War is hell, but movies about war are awesome. And while war movies have entertained generations, they also serve as a cultural guidepost, reflecting the most recent war and as purveyors of a stylized idea of war and how it's fought. For example, the First World War, or the Great War as it was originally known when we were explicitly told that there would not be a sequel, is foundational to our cultural perception of war, and it permeates science fiction portrayals of combat. In The Empire Strikes Back, we have this iconic scene of rebels defending their fortified trenches while lumbering Imperial armor advances across an open plain. It makes no sense. They came from space. The Empire could have bombed them from orbit and landed their forces literally anywhere and bypassed the slogging ground advance. But it's a shorthand for the idea of combat. We see it again in Attack of the Clones, and more recently in Solo, with this sequence that almost looks straight out of the Psalm. We see it in Firefly, trenches and infantry taking potshots at each other. Even Star Trek Deep Space Nine gives us combat that could almost be from a Ferengi remake of All's Quiet on the Western Front. While the trenches, mass charges, and clumsy armored assaults of the Great War make up the foundation of our cultural image of war, we also have these elements of more recent conflicts. The D-Day landings echo through film depictions of wars both future and past. And Vietnam, America's first big military humiliation on the world stage.
Thank you, sir. May I have another?
My favorite Vietnam War movie is Aliens. Granted, it's set centuries later, in space, fighting against giant bugs, but it's a Nam movie. For those who somehow haven't seen it, we follow a group of colonial marines, which is a bit misleading because while they're called Marines, they are a clear callback to the low-morale conscript army of the early 1970s. And like Vietnam, they go in overconfident.
I only need to know one thing. Where they are.
Go best guess, kick ass.
Anytime, anywhere.
But with leadership that hampers their ability to fight.
Look, we can't have any firing in there. I want you to collect magazines from everybody.
With predictable results against an enemy that attacks out of nowhere and then disappears back into the surroundings. It's worth noting that Ripley's character arc in this film is similar to Rambo's in First Blood 2, co-written by James Cameron. Veteran with PTSD goes back, faces their demons, and finds redemption, recovering from the trauma in the process. Sticking with James Cameron for a while, we see the shift to the next war with Avatar. Soldiers fighting in a jungle. It's another Nam movie, right? Partly. This time it's heavily influenced by the GWAT. At its core, it's a resource war. There would be no military presence on Pandora if it weren't for the presence of unobtainium, which is a dumb name for something here in the process of obtaining, but I digress. They tried to get the natives to give up their silly tree religion and teach them to wear pants and live in houses like civilized people, but for whatever reason they'd rather smurf and ride dragons than go to school, so let's bomb them. The story focuses on the technological disparity. These soldiers in their pixelated camouflage that was fashionable among militaries around the turn of the century, and their machines that they're dependent on, versus primitive screwheads with sharp sticks. Soldiers fighting not for some ideological dispute, not to stop the relentless expansion of the communist or xenomorph menace, but simply to extract a valuable resource from the ground. Avatar gives us something else to consider, too. Unlike, say, Star Wars or Star Trek, Avatar holds tightly to the speed of light as a hard limit for communications. Consequently, the Marines on site have a much higher level of autonomy than is the case in modern conflicts.
That's called taking the initiative, son.
They can't call for support. They can't request changes to the rules of engagement. They have to make their own decisions on how to best accomplish their broad mission, even as conditions on the ground change. The same is true in Aliens. This squad of Marines are on their own. The ranking officer on the planet is this green lieutenant.
How many combat drops?
Two. Including this one.
And the only way that help is coming is if they don't make it back on time.
How long after we're declared overdue can we expect a rescue?
17 days.
I'm going to talk more about interstellar comms and military logistics in another video, because that's not what draws us to war movies. We don't want stories about the details of logistics that actually win armed conflicts. We want the action. The explosions and mayhem and death. The violent spectacle is what gets butts in seats and eyeballs on screen. But why does that have such broad appeal? And I say this as a lifelong fan of the genre. I sometimes wonder if it's simply that war movies, whether set in a historical context or a fantasy or sci-fi setting, speak to us on the same level that war itself does. There's a deep and powerful draw to it. As Robert E. Lee famously said at Fredericksburg, "It is well that war is so terrible, lest we grow too fond of it." I'm not really qualified to pontificate on the true face of combat. I'm not a spec ops vet with 5 tours in Badassistan. The closest I've ever been to combat is teaching high school in Detroit. But I can attest to the appeal of martial language and the appreciation of well-crafted weapons. I'll confess to watching Band of Brothers and being grateful I never had to storm the beaches of Normandy or fight in a Bastogne winter, while simultaneously longing for it on some level. I'm generally anti-war in policy discussions, but if, in my 20s, some buddies of mine had said, "Hey, you should come invade Iraq with us," I'd likely have been game. There's something in us, something that transcends reason or language or even emotion, that resonates with the idea of war. The old, "what if they had a war and nobody came," has yet to happen. There's always enough of a draw for the show to go on. James Hillman, a psychologist and also a Navy corpsman during World War II, wrote a book exploring exactly this idea, A Terrible Love of War. It's a little rambling, it folds back on itself a few times, and it doesn't quite succeed in making a decisive point. Kind of like this channel, come to think of it. But it gives you a lot to think about, even when he occasionally stretches his argument beyond the reach of his evidence. There's a passage that's relevant to this particular discussion. It could be claimed that war on TV, in movies, and played on video games offers a window into the sublime. These mediated wars provide an aestheticized terror, battle and death as spectacle. Similar to a work of art, war is framed and plotted, its sequences selected, the whole unified and limited in time. You can stop it anywhere, turn it off anytime. What I find interesting here is that now we're seeing a blending of war as spectacle and war as reality. In the American Civil War, artists drew battle scenes for newspapers to be consumed by people far from the front. During the World Wars, camera crews crafted newsreels played in movie theaters. The Vietnam War was piped into living rooms on the evening news, though in carefully constructed bites. The invasions of Afghanistan and Iraq had live reports from embedded reporters. Today, every other soldier has a GoPro on his helmet, and you can binge on combat footage all day. You want to know what's happening in Ukraine or Gaza? You can watch firefights from the viewpoint of soldiers on both sides. The violence and death is real, but safely on the other side of a screen. And a lot of modern war is conducted with drones. I say with, not by, because a Reaper drone isn't the Terminator. It isn't autonomous. It has an operator, a human being behind a screen, seeing what it sees, making the decision whether to kill. I've occasionally heard people make jokes about drone operators with PTSD, but I see how it can happen. Bombing Taliban with a drone is physically no different than playing Call of Duty for the operator, but to know that it's real, that it has real-world consequences, that weighs on the mind. It's an idea we've seen explored in science fiction going back at least as far as Ender's Game, and reality has finally caught up. Yet, it's also gone backwards in some ways. Ukraine gives us scenes like some sci-fi Great War film, with tanks advancing on trenches with no apparent concept of combined arms operations, while drones fly over dropping grenades like a modern parody of British pilots in biplanes, flying over German trenches and hand-dropping bombs over the side. And we watched it until it got boring and a new war came along. Because wars, like movies, are based on story. If they lag in the middle, the audience gets bored. And we can think of wars by proxy and drones as a narrative cheat. They're a way to inflict casualties on an enemy without taking them ourselves. Bodies coming home in bags tell a counter-narrative that makes people question the war, or, more specifically, the story of the war. It's like a B-plot line that directly contradicts the A-plot. With that dissonance, the story doesn't work. Or put another way, if you try to make a movie but you don't know anything about filmmaking, it's probably going to be a disaster. But you don't need to be a professional filmmaker to know if a movie is good or if it was worth making. The same principle applies to wars. That took a couple turns I didn't quite expect, but I'm going to run with it.